They actually built these rooms for studio use. So if you look in here, there's no corners. There's no 90 degree angles. All the walls are not symmetrical, right? So that's perfect for studio space. The space actually didn't have the treatment on the walls. I had to do the treatment and everything in here. And then I bought this big, well, it's not big, this larger mixer behind me, console behind me. And so I wanted to center everything around that. So basically, when you start spending money on studio gear, you can't stop. So, you know, I kind of jumped on board with the API a couple of years ago with a smaller format mixer. And I said I need more inputs because I started buying all these analog keyboards. I had the same relationship that a lot of artists do. Back in the day, they had the analog keyboards and then they kind of migrate into the computer. And then I woke up and said, you know what? I don't feel inspired to do music anymore. I need to get back outside the box. So I bought the 1608. And then my speakers, those Barefoot MM12s are the flagship speaker range for that brand, and they sound phenomenal. So once I got those, I said, you know, I can't really stop. Either go big or go home. So, so I just wanted to make sure I had a nice, cozy, like, I didn't need a big space, because if you get too big of a space, you kind of lose the intimacy of the room. So I wanted something that was really easy to come in and just to be able to just like work and chill, but not chill so much where you don't get anything done. And of course, I put a big ass TV on the wall, which kind of makes it a little bit harder, because I always want a movie on in the background to kind of help me stay inspired. I have a lot of old school stuff. I have a lot of new old school stuff. All of my stuff in here is reissued. So I wanted all new old stuff because I don't want to worry about like maintenance on like a 30-year-old synthesizer. Like that's not my thing. The Moog One, that's an updated version of the memory Moog, loosely, right? But it still does far beyond. Decker's Dream is completely different. Everybody has the same story behind Decker's Dream. Like, they grew up loving Blade Runner, right? The sound, you're like, oh. It's like, you kind of attach yourself to those kind of things. Growing up, listening to Blade Runner, you're attached to those sounds, and you're like, wow, somebody's making it again? Whoa, I can get one? Wow. So I bought it. And it sounds amazing. You need a polyphonic aftertouch MIDI controller with that thing to bring out all the expressiveness in it. But when you sit down and you mess with it, oh my God, it's so insane. Like, there's nothing in here that touches it like that. And to me, that's a big deal. Like, for a set that came out like decades ago, to still be like, that's probably why it's in that rarefied, like, holy grail synth category, because there's not a lot of synths that can do all that stuff that it can do. And honestly, now I'm gonna blow smoke up their ass. That shit is amazing. I have a problem with sticking to a formula. So when I come in here, there is no basic setup. I mean, as far as software, I use Ableton. Ableton Live is fantastic. I mean, as far as getting out of the way technically and letting the creativity flow, like on the sessions page, you can do a bunch of clips and stuff. That for me is amazing. But as far as which keyboards I go to first, there is no first, really, to be honest. It's like, it just depends. It's a feel. Music has always been a feel for me, a vibe. And it doesn't have to necessarily be, you know, this, okay, I better write exactly what I did down when I came in the studio that day because I did that great track. I don't want to do that way because then, it becomes a certain like saneness with the music when you do it that way, if that makes sense. That that sounds so doofy, but like, I'm not a technical guy. I'm not a trained musician, man. I'm just like, I'm all about vibe. It's all about that for me. I'm not coming in here like getting on my knees praying and going, oh, bring me the, no. It's just a feel. You come in, what's that do? Blah, blah, blah. And you go, wow, that's a cool sound. Da-da-da-da. Oh, that's pretty sweet. And then I'm sure a lot of people do that. But other people are probably more specific and detailed doing their process, where I'm just like all over the place. Sometimes I can come in here and, you know, some of these keyboards, they have sequencers on them. And I can, you know, hold a chord down and turn on the arpeggiator or whatever, or program a sequence in one of the keyboards, and then that can be the bed for the new track. And then you can just turn on the drum machine and you go, you know what, that's it. You don't need anything else. So it could be something that simple. I'm not a keyboard player. I'm not a musician. I'm just, right? Just like everybody else. And then you find something that sounds good to your ear, and then that's where I get my vibe off of, the melody or whatever that I'm doing. And then I'll quickly like record it inside Ableton, which is amazing for that, because you just record a clip and then you just go to the next melody, right? And that's both MIDI and audio, because sometimes when I record the melody and then I go back and then I quantize it, it loses the feel, right? So I do both MIDI and audio, because a lot of times I'm off, right? And the off part sounds better than the more quantized part. So if it's MIDI, I'll go back, then I'll worry about tweaking and getting some kind of really cool sound with the knobs and stuff. We have the left and the right side. One is the creative side and the other one's the analytical side. I'm all day on the creative side. I'm left heavy. Analytical shit, when it comes to making music, nah. The way that the studio's arranged right now, in 2 days I'll probably rearrange it, except for the mixer and the speakers and stuff, because I don't like to have the same thing anymore. It's a weird fetish of mine to kind of move things around to keep it fresh and interesting for me. The less constraints I have, the better for me, because then I feel too boxed in creatively to the only thing I'm missing is a reverb, a small hall that, you know, nah. Even though I have all the gear to do that, will somebody please come in here and work all this gear? I use probably 10% of the capacity of this room. I'm a gear slut. I'm a self-proclaimed gear slut, and I'm proud of my sluttiness. Did that come out right? I'm proud to be a slut for the gear.